Thank you, Leap of Faith, for sharing in worship leadership and for the beautiful music today. Grace to you and peace this day from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I wanted to talk about milestones. You know what a milestone is? It might be a year or a year in which something happens, like a life event, some sort of culminating moment. And I want you to think of some on your own. We'll talk about that in a minute, and I'll give you an example so we're on the same page. For example, when you become 16 years old, you're able to get a permit to learn how to drive, and now in Pennsylvania, you need to wait 6 months, and after 6 months, you can get your driver's license, and you can drive. And for a lot of us, that's a milestone. It means all sorts of things for us moving forward if we have our own transportation and our driver's license. So something like that. So what are the milestones that have been or are important to you in your life? Anybody have an example? Donna. Great, wow. So, yeah, being finished with school. Congratulations. Yeah, that's a milestone when we graduate, maybe from high school or college or trade school or graduate, whatever. You know, we have that milestone when we grab that diploma and we don't have to go to class anymore. Another milestone. Anyone have one? A birthday when you begin a new decade. A milestone. And when we admit it and we're glad for it and we're not afraid of it. Yeah, great. And happy birthday, by the way. Linda, I heard you. I don't know if everybody else did. Buying a home, right, is a milestone. Sometimes we, you know, somebody said last night about buying a home, that buying a home for her was getting out of her parents' watchful eye so that she could do whatever she wanted, you know? So it might be that, or it might just be you're not renting anymore. You have a place that you can call your own, and there's a lot of pride in that. Thank you. Others, other milestones. Right. Wedding anniversaries are remarkable things because you celebrate love over a number of years, and you have those milestone years, and we have like colors and gifts associated with those years as well. An adoption of a child. Yes, wonderful, because that's a process, isn't it? Okay, so for that filing to come through. Getting out of debt, yeah, paying off a debt and the freedom, you know, that's an accomplishment. Are there others? By the way, I shortened the sermon so we could spend some time on this, so feel free to share.
Marathons,
yeah, you work up to those, don't you? Yeah, so the 26.2 miles, but there are longer ones than that, aren't there? Ultra marathons, wow. Yeah, so that's an amazing, that's a milestone, that's an accomplishment.
Phases of a building project.
Phases of a building project, right? Yeah, because that takes a lot of your time.
Okay.
And you're in chaos, sort of, until it's finished. And there's a lot of reward in it being finished. Are there others?
Retirement,
yeah. You get to that point in life where you're able to retire, and someone said last night, now she can do whatever she wants, right? You know, and that's part of it as well. Yeah, are there others? The birth of your children. Yeah, that's a milestone for many who are called to parenthood to have that happen. And then their weddings, another milestone for sure. Becoming a grandparent, And I haven't experienced that yet, but I hear that's just a wonderful thing to see your child have a child. It's just, it's a love that you can't put into words, yeah. Yes, like a really, like a big vacation that you've been planning for, maybe saving for a long time, sure. Are there others? Okay, well, this is what I like about having four worship services. I have a message from one of the worship services to this worship service. Has anybody of late become a great, great, great aunt? Yeah, how many of those do we have in the congregation? That's pretty. Okay, well, all right. So, in case you didn't know, that's Sue's. Yeah. But anyway, so you get the you get the idea. We have those moments. We have those milestones, and sometimes we think of them as like mountaintop moments that are life-changing. And I thought about this this weekend because of our scripture reading today from the Gospel according to Matthew. We are in Matthew chapter 5, which is the beginning of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. So he goes up to a mountain and he begins to teach them. Our reading that was appointed for last week, the fourth Sunday after the Epiphany, was the first verses of chapter 5. We didn't hear it because we had a festival last week, so we heard the story of the presentation. But these are pretty familiar words, and we've heard them before, and we will hear them again. Jesus begins his Sermon on the Mount with the Beatitudes. They're some of the most beloved words of Scripture, where Jesus says, for example, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God." And there are a couple more as well. This is going to sound like an advertisement. I think in some ways it is. This past Thursday, the first Thursday of every month, we had our Bible study, the four pages of the sermon, and we talked about this text. And there was just some wonderful interaction and participation that night. And one of the things that Pastor Richard said that I think is very true, and we're going to see this because we're going to go through the Gospel of Matthew this year, is that every time Jesus goes up to a mountain, something remarkable happens. In Matthew's gospel, this is the first time he goes up to the mountain and he shares his teaching with the Sermon on the Mount. But you know, like milestones and mountaintop experiences, we know that we're not always able to stay there, are we? Stay with our accomplishment, stay on the top of the mountain. We're sort of, you know, called to do something with those teachings or with those things that have happened in our life. And Jesus will come off the mountain in the end of chapter 7. But before he does that, and in our scripture reading for today, he really puts some focus on us and what we are called to do as the profoundly blessed children of God, as we just heard in the Beatitudes. And he does that in a couple of ways. Our lesson begins today with verse 13. "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored?" You know, when you think about it, salt is really a remarkable mineral. We use it to enhance flavor. It's used as a preservative. You can throw salt on your driveway and it can melt the ice and the snow. It does all of these things. And in ancient times, salt was even used as currency. That's why the words salt and salary are very similar. They're from the same root word. And there were times that people would be paid with salt. because it was that valuable and that important. And when we think about it, salt in and of itself, and Jesus talks about this, he warns about this, salt in and of itself is just salt. For the most part, we don't just eat salt, right? We use it to enhance the flavor of something else, or we use it to preserve something else. And so salt, and for Jesus to say you are the salt of the earth, we are being called not just to say I'm blessed because I'm salt, but we're being called to do something, to be the type of people in our lives and in our world that enhances the flavor of our circumstances and gives hope and joy to others as well. And then to further drive home the point, Jesus says in verse 14, you are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. And we know that light's a remarkable thing. Light shines into the darkness and illuminates. It shows us things that we wouldn't have otherwise been able to see. It illuminates our path. And light in and of itself, you know, if you've ever had those experiences where you've been sort of blinded by some sort of light, isn't useful to us. But a light that enlightens the world is the light that Jesus calls us to be. And we can only be salt and light because Jesus is the salt and the light. And we share the gifts of Jesus with one another. So you are the salt of the world. You are the light of the world. And this is a remarkable thing. It is a blessing, but what we want to be careful of is we just think that it's a blessing for ourselves. Hey, look at me, I'm the salt of the earth. That's not what Jesus is talking about. He's talking about how we are gifted and we are equipped to go out and to do something so that the world may know the love of Jesus Christ. Another thing we don't want to do is to say that our life of faith is just simply one aspect of who we are. I know we have other aspects of our life. We live daily lives. We live in the secular world. But our faith is at the center of all of that. And when we live each day, we can be salt and we can be light for other people. What Jesus shares with us today is a profound truth for our lives and for our world. You know, when you think about it, we talked about those milestones. We don't just stay there with them, do we? When the building's finished, we move into the building and use it, right? When we learn how to drive, we don't just say, oh, I got my license, look at me. We go out and drive, and we learn to service a car and put gas in it, and we learn, you know. When we graduate from somewhere, we use that degree so that we're equipped to do the work that we're called to do. And that's what Jesus is telling us today. As the blessed, precious children of God, we are called to be sight, to be I combine them. We are called to be salt and light for the world. May we embrace who we are and whose we are, the blessed and beloved children of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.